Hello and welcome to the latest in our sessions for the Student Masterclasses 2020. And in this session, we're going to explore the wonderful world of visual effects and what it takes to produce BAFTA, RTS and award-winning shows that have create astonishing worlds. With me is Russell Dodgson, who is responsible for a host of things you see on your screen, but most recently his Dark Materials, which is based on Philip Pullman's novels. But in his background, he's worked on James Bond and Harry Potter franchises. He's worked doing wonderful things for Nat Geo, Black Mirror, USS Callister, and a whole eclectic bunch of stuff. So I want to ask Russell in his opening remarks, what has your career been up to so far? How did you get to here?
Well, that's a pretty broad question. I've had a real mix of a beginning, I would say. I started out, which I think where the best place to begin is. Let me think. So I started out editing. I started out at university studying to be an editor. And my cousin, his name's Mark Fox, is a BBC editor, or he was at the time. And he was editing natural history. And I found what he did to be incredibly fascinating. The way he took multiple pieces of footage from multiple times and multiple locations and created a narrative out of it. And I thought that was amazing. And it really opened my eyes up to what I could do, because before that I was just a kid that liked watching movies. So I took a bit of a career sort of divergence, because at that time I thought I was going to be a karate instructor, strangely. So I went off to university, I studied editing, I left, and then I took another strange sort of side detour after sort of learning editing and enjoying that a lot. And I actually became a breakdancer for a while, because when I was younger, my passion was always martial arts and physical activity. And I became a breakdancer because of my love of the music and my love of movement. And then eventually it just so happened that my best friend, and who's a DOP named Paul O'Callaghan, I was incredibly fortunate to find out that he had gone to university, because we lost touch for a while, and he had gone to university to study cinematography. And we decided we were going to start our own company, and we were going to shoot lifestyle movies, and we ended up very strangely in architecture doing launch movies for cities they were building in the Middle East. And I would direct them, Paul would shoot them, and when I got back, I would supervise the visual effects. And sort of in between those two times, I watched the DVD extras for Black Hawk Down and saw how they did the visual effects for that, and I was mesmerized by it. And I didn't really realize that this was a career or an industry. And I realized that editing for me, which was something I found really, really exciting, and movie making was really exciting to me, I realized that there was something missing, and it was a sort of a technical problem solving issue that I really wanted to be able to do. And when I saw visual effects, I realized that really melded those ideas of like science and art and pushed them together and allowed you to really get involved in story in quite a unique way. So I went and did a master's at Bournemouth in that. And when I came out, that knowledge plus me beginning this company with my best friend, we ended up shooting and post-producing these launch movies, which, you know, got me at a very young age of 23, 24, with sort of crews of sort of 90 people in Cairo shooting these kind of lifestyle things with lots of actors and actresses. And that was a really great start for me. And then it just so happened that through the beginnings of me doing that, those visual effects, I learned a piece of software called Nuke, which is now the industry standard compositing software. And I just happened to learn it really early on at the time when everybody in London decided they wanted to transition to it. So I ended up going to Framestore. And from that point, that was really the beginning of my true visual effects career. But actually, I think a lot of those different melting pot background activities and interests really helped me get to that place.
So I'm a factual producer by background, and so I'm really as far in the opposite direction as you are from visual effects. So we are going to attempt to demystify some of it during this session. And for those watching, no question is too humble, and I hope to be able to be putting questions to Russell, who's going to talk us through his work on his dark materials. And as I said before, it's based on a series of novels by Philip Pullman. And the setup is that each human character has an animal spirit or a demon as they go through the narrative in the books and the programs. So, you know, part of Russell's task, not only to help build the characters physically and digitally, but also to understand those animals he's creating and where they their place in the story. So shall we see the first clip and then you can tell us a little bit about it, Russell?
Sure, let's have a look.
It is a lot more comfortable than Oxford.
And it's our new home.
We should rest.
If they try to stop me taking my armor, they die.
That seems fair.
Good.
Make your mind go blank again. You should be good at that.
One blow will crush a seal's skull, or break a man's back, and we can bite.
Either being ignorant or willfully obstructive.
What are you thinking? You started the fight. Now you're losing the fight.
I know what you're gonna say.
Bottle. Nice. Love it. More of that. Hey!
Amazing stuff. We're going to see quite a lot of the bears in later clips, but should we start with the golden monkey you saw right at the beginning and then dotted through that tape? The golden monkey is the demon of Mrs. Coulter, who's one of the baddies. Talk about how you helped with the backstory, how you understood what you wanted to do with that.
Yeah, I think the thing to start with that's really interesting about the show, and you know, watching that back, it normally on past jobs you kind of just remember the trauma, but I really enjoy watching that stuff because I just love the premise of the show and I've always loved those books. So it's really nice to sort of watch something and remember it fondly. Anyway, the thing about Mrs. Coulter and the thing about all the demons is the demons represent a side of your body. They represent your soul and kind of your inner spirit. And because of that, they offer this really amazing opportunity in animation to augment or flavor a performance with subtext, which I think is really a kind of a real joy. And it's a real rare thing for us in animation to get to do. So with Mrs. Coulter, we have this challenge. Like normally all of the demons can speak, but in the case of her, her demon never speaks, which means we have to portray emotion as well as a relationship. And that character also has a three book character arc. The monkey and Mrs. Coulter, they both have a character arc. And you have to do all of that without any dialogue, which is really interesting. And I think the other thing that's really interesting is that we as artists and me as a supervisor, we have this really intense duty of care on this show because we have to put a golden monkey in a sort of delicate and powerful drama sequence with an actress as powerful as Ruth Wilson and not destroy her performance. Like we have to nail it and we have to be careful. So what that takes is it's a massive exercise in restraint. Like you can kind of do anything in visual effects these days. And actually the hardest thing is to not do things and hold back and know where your place is within a shot and what your job is. And our job predominantly on this show is to reinforce the story and the other characters' arcs. So what we did is we spent quite a lot of time with Ruth. She became very, very close with her puppeteer, Brian Fisher, who did just an amazing job puppeteering the monkey. And through that relationship, they started to work out how they move around a room, how they respond to each other. And that really helped them on set. Then I would spend quite a lot of time both with Ruth and with Brian working out what kind of the emotional beats of the scene were and what Ruth wanted them to be and what the director wanted them to be so that we could play to that all the way through post-production. We then, after filming, we then got Ruth, who was very giving with her time. She came into Framestore and I interviewed her for an hour or two and we recorded the interview. And it was me kind of asking her questions about her character and her character's backstory. Because the interesting thing in the books is that the demons or the demons that you have, the form that they take, they change when you're a child because you haven't worked out who you are yet. And then when you hit puberty and you mature, they settle as what you become. So at some point, Mrs. Coulter, who is, you know, she's described in the books as the cesspit of moral filth, which is quite a strong description. She, at some point in her childhood, settled as this kind of cheeky, mischievous monkey. And it's quite contrary to what her character is now, which means at some point in her history, there must have been some kind of trauma that made her have this break in her bond with the monkey. So we kind of went into that and we learned as much as we could. And from that, we derived new ideas about how they would be more comfortable apart than together, but how the monkey could help reinforce her status because it's such a beautiful animal. It could reinforce her status in public. So when they're out, they kind of play act together as this sort of powerful couple. But when they're at home, they're separate. And through all of that, we start working out how we can flavor the relationship and flavor the details of a scene. And I think one scene in particular really stands out, which is where Mrs. Coulter tells Lyra that Azrael is her father. And this is a real showstopper of a bit of news for Lyra. And in that moment, we wanted to sort of somehow, even though Mrs. Coulter is standoffish and not comforting Lyra in how upset she is, we wanted to show just like a little hint of that. So what we had is we just had the monkey sitting at her feet and that monkey just does like a little half step forward and a little lean in when Lyra's at her most upset and then sort of settles back. And just that little bit of flavor gives you that subtext that adds to the scene, but without overpowering anything. So yeah, it's a great job to do that one.
My common misconception about visual effects is it's a bank of people behind a bank of computers doing wizardry. But actually, what you're saying is that it's really about storytelling. Would you say that's the case?
Yeah. I mean, 100%. I mean, I always say the same thing, really, which is that anybody who is privileged enough to interact with narrative for a job, it is blessed. And all people do is choose their medium with which they get to interact with story. That's how I look at it. You know, whether you're a photographer, a playwright, a theatre actor, or in our case, our animators are actors. That's what they are. You know, so what happens is if you think about the relationship, once we finish filming and I have absorbed the director's intent of the episode and the scenes and the actor's intent, I take that and I look at the entire sequence. And when the edit has changed and the tone of some of the scenes has shifted, I take that and I direct the animators by saying, this is what Mrs. Coulter is trying to get out of this scene. This is her goal. So all I do is I give them playable action and things that they're trying to achieve. And then, but what we're doing is we're then translating that into what the subtext of we can show is, like whether she's totally confident with her moment, in which case the monkey is very much in line with her, whether the monkey is doing something contradictory because she feels something else. And I'm saying that to the animators, and what I don't do in the way that I supervise, some supervisors are different, but I try not to be too specific. I don't say put this foot here and put that foot there. I propose a scenario and let the animators offer up a performance, which is just being an actor. And then all I do is I then make slight adjustments to it to make sure it hits the tone or make sure an expression really gets everything we can out of it. And then it's done. So it's a director-actor relationship that I have. They are incredibly talented and they offer performances. So it is storytelling. And obviously behind all of that is a huge bank of technology, but all technology is in the world of visual effects is people making tools to allow artists to be artists, not to be scientists.
Yeah, you described your job to me as like conducting an orchestra. And you also said for a production as huge as His Dark Material, as you have between 400 and 600 people contributing to it in one way or another, just walk us through who some of those people are, what their roles are, and if you have entry-level roles, how would you become a visual effects person?
Yeah, sure. So there's definitely an entry level to the industry, and that is that you learn with the more basic tasks to learn. So often there's kind of two strands. I mean, this is shifting over time now with game engines and new technology, but the traditional route really is you either work in 2D or 3D. So 2D, the entry route is rotoscoping, which is fundamentally drawing round characters and doing paint to clean things up, to extract characters and put them in front of other things. And the 3D equivalent is match moving, which is where you track the three-dimensional camera so that you have a virtual camera that moves identically to the one that happened in the real world, which then allows you to add things to that scene. Now, the thing about visual effects is that it's a team effort. So if your roto is bad and your track is bad, the shots are bad. So even from that very early stage, what you're doing is on screen, visible, allows other people to do their job properly, and is vital. And if it goes wrong, it can ruin a shot. And then from there, you move up through the ranks. So in 2D, you go through being a compositor and multiple layers of compositor. And that job is best described as moving Photoshop, but sort of on acid. And it's a very creative, responsive, interactive job, often where you're solving problems and putting together the final image. And then when you go into 3D, it sort of explodes out into a million routes, where you can do animation, simulations of fire and smoke and water. You can do rigging, which is creating the bone structure of the animals for the animators to do their job. That's a slightly more scientific job or mathematical job. You can do, let's think what else. There's lighting, which is basically the same as being a gaffer on set and lighting the set. There's grooming, which is giving CG creatures digital haircuts. There's creating muscle systems. And then there's also developing the tools and the software to make all of those artists be able to do their jobs properly. And you can focus on characters and you can focus on environments and world building or map painting. And it's such a vast world, but really you just get in at those two routes and then you sort of find out what you like and work your way up. It's a good industry for diversifying as well, I find.
What sort of background would you need to join your team?
I think you normally find that people come from either a straight arts background or a computer science background. And when I say that, it doesn't mean that you're a computer scientist or you have a degree. It means that that's kind of how your brain works and what you're interested in. I mean, you know, we have people who start with come in pre-university and end up, you know, rocketing and becoming incredible. And we just train them up and it almost like it's just a skills ladder that you're working through. I think what really helps is two things. If you come from a science background, science is a very, very, in my mind, lofty field. It's academic, right? So if you're amazing at maths, you know, we have some of our supervisors come from a physics PhD background. That's where they've come from. I really think it's important to feel that entertainment and images is worthy of science. If you don't feel that way, then you're wasting your science knowledge because you could be off, you know, helping someone irrigate in a third world country. You know what I mean? It's got to be something that you see as being worthwhile of the knowledge that you have. And I think for that, you have to have a love of entertainment, a love of images, and a love of creating tools for people that then allow them to do their job as well. So I think that's the science side, personally. And I think if you're more of a pure artist, I think the skill is observation. And actually, I mean, observation kind of applies to both. I mean, I always say that if you watch a movie, you should never watch a movie as a passive viewer. You should watch a movie as an active viewer if you want to do this industry. You should try and work out why it is that a wide lens close up makes you feel a more intimate relationship with an actor, or why a long lens, you know, gives you a completely different feeling, or why the movement of that camera just felt right, and why those decisions are being made. So I think if you're a passive viewer, it's less useful. I think if you can be an active viewer and also decide what you like, because you're trying to put you into your work. So, and I've given you two instances of science and art, and because visual effects is this, you normally find that it's this big sliding scale between those two things that applies to what you should do for different jobs.
So should we move on to the next clip, sure. Which is about building worlds and environments. Perhaps you'd like to set it up and explain what we're going to see.
Yeah, sure. So, I mean, visual effects, you do a lot to try and augment or help the storytelling process. And you, if your CG characters are your actors, then your environments are your production design and art department. And you're basically just creating the things that the production either can't physically build, can't afford to build, or just are impossible things. So that's where you start seeing blue screens and green screens come in. And this is where I'd say that environments come from quite an early and quite artistic place, because you normally start with beautiful concept art that gives you and sells the director or a studio the idea of a place and the idea of a world. So there's this idea of world building, which is where you're building the fabric of an environment to try and flavor it again with tone and mood. So on His Dark Materials, what's crazy is that the book is is the odyssey of this girl, the first book is anyway, and every episode is basically a new place. So we burn through environments very quickly, which means we have to augment a lot of things. So we go from anything from adding more spires and changing around buildings in Oxford skylines, to creating boats on waters, to building environments like snowy mountaintops and glaciers and things like that. So let's have a look. I mean, let's just play the clip and you can see the kind of variety of work that we did.
an embarrassment of riches to talk about there, Russell. So can you explain what we're seeing?
Oh, we can't hear. So is take something that is already amazing and make it more amazing, I guess, is the way of looking at it. So Joel Collins
is getting the master.
So Joel Collins, the production designer, he designed, for example, a town called Trollesund. Now, there is no town called Trollesund. We couldn't travel to Norway because, you know, there's the restrictive nature of our shoot, cast, cost of traveling, schedule, all the usual things that get in the way of any decision on set. So what we did is we actually built a third to half of the town in a quarry in the Brecon Beacons that we then, the production visual effects art director and his team, they built that in a game engine in Unreal so that they could explore it and allowed us to put buildings in a place where when you were inside the town, you didn't see out of the town. So they weren't visual effects shots. And then we could choose the moments where we would have visual effects shots to expand the world out. So they are the big wide shots, adding in the harbor, adding in the water. And that is done with a combination of two-dimensional traditional map painting, 3D buildings, and fully 3D worlds. The same with the stuff in the sky with the balloon. It's very hard to get a ridiculous cloudscape and a sunset and a balloon and a helicopter all in the same place at the same time. So we sort of just create it. A lot of it is done from reference and observation. So I went to Iceland and did, I think, 8 hours in a helicopter over glaciers and landscapes filming, and also filming plates and photography on the ground, which we then either used, augmented, or used as reference. So it's a real mix. It's a real mix. It uses a lot of the different talents of the different artists. And I think, again, it's all about referencing reality to try and give yourself, even when you're being fantastical, like, you know, when we did our Northern Lights, we had to do the Northern Lights, but times 10. But you're still trying to reference the original, but just making the kind of more sort of steroidal, crazy version of it.
And how many of your team are actually at that quarry in Wales?
So my production team, it can change depending on the shoot. I have... because the show is so large, what I tend to do is, it's that kind of orchestra idea again, is that I kind of sit on the top of the whole team and I'm either preparing or helping to work out future episodes and large set pieces. So I'm either with directors, producers in the studio, and then I have another supervisor who is on set who is acquiring the footage that is, you know, so a part of the job when you're on set is just making sure you have the correct references, the correct information to allow visual effects artists to then do their job. So what lens were we on? Is the camera moving? What was the lighting like? What reference charts do I need to help them do their job? There's that character who's a really important job. We had Rob Duncan, who's a brilliant visual effects supervisor on the team with us. You also have data wranglers, who are the people who work with him to take all the photographs, reference photography, hold the references, and basically he orchestrates them on the floor. We then have a LiDAR team who are doing laser scanning of every set all day, every day. They're just laser scanning sets. So we have to the millimeter accurate data of all of the environments. We then have a scanning team. So what we do is we cycle all the actors through a 360 degree photo booth, basically, and they get photographed from every angle in every type of lighting so we can make the digital version of them if we need to. And then if you have a second unit, you then have all of that again, apart from the LiDAR and the photo booth. And then there's also visual effects producers, there are visual effects line producers, there are production managers, you know, it's a full unit of support.
So I've got a couple of questions here. One from Helen: how long did each episode, and how many people working full or part-time? Well, I think we've said between 400 or 600 across the production, haven't we? But how long for each episode?
What, to do the effects? It's a bit tricky. Unlike film, where you have, you know, you start and then you have a definite end, it's kind of like you deliver in December and you start in January. TV is like a marathon and a sprint at the same time. It's like kind of taking Valium and drinking Red Bull, I guess, or something like that. It's really an intense workload. So, you know, I think we started executing visual effects shots, and there's a difference because we'd already built the assets prior to this. But we started executing visual effects shots, I believe, in March, and we delivered in early November, and that's 8 episodes. And what happens is you have a whole period of time when you're basically working on everything, and then you get into delivery where you're delivering an episode every week to 2 weeks, and we had 1,900 shots, or 1,950 or something like that. So I think you probably find that each episode maybe has 3 months of work, maybe 4, but happening in parallel and offset with teams going from one thing to another. It's like a big military maneuver trying to get everybody to work, because what you have is you have the animators who have animators blocking the animation in episode 2, for example, but also working on the final animation in episode 1. And then when they finish episode 1, they move on to episode 3, and another team might do episode 2. So you can structure it in lots of different ways. And then in terms of the crew numbers, yeah, I think about 400 people probably, or 500 people probably touch the show, but you probably have a smaller core team that's constant of maybe about 60 or something like that, maybe 100. I think one really good statistic to take into account, which is why I always say there's no button that makes visual effects. So we worked out that if one person was to sit down and make the bear Yorick on his own, it would take about 300 days just straight to make him. Which is obviously a lot of time and art.
Before we get to the bear, which we're shortly going to move on to, we've got another question from James, who says, how do you feel about the progression of virtual productions from a VFX perspective?
That's a really good question, and sort of very topical. I think it's interesting that what's happened of late is virtual production has sort of been rebranded by what they've done on The Mandalorian, but virtual production has kind of been around in iterative stages for a long time. You know, there's been like the painting practice, for example, who are working on this show. They've been doing that for quite a while, but they just haven't been filming LED screens using a game engine. So I think that really what the news is with virtual production is that it is always better for visual effects to be used early on to help you plan. And what's happened of late between the sort of maturation of game engines, the improvements in LED screens, and to be honest, COVID as well, coronavirus, they have kind of propelled people's desire to use these tools to help them get to where they want to go. So I think tools that have already been around have become more relevant to the people with the money, basically, and more appealing for them to use. Especially, I think, because in cinema now, you know, I think studios are kind of quite risk averse. So lots of, you know, prep, being able to see their action sequences before they, you know, shoot them is a good thing. I also think there's another thing that's happening at the moment, which is the muddying of the term virtual production, which I think some people think is just sort of filming LED screens like they've done on The Mandalorian, which if we're talking about that, it is in its infancy. It is very early days on that. And I think that there's like the truth, there's the PR, and somewhere in the middle of that is probably where everything sits. But it is something that will evolve and keep improving over time. And it's useful.
And then just one quick question, which is from a lay person, from a producer's perspective, how does a producer prepare or think about wanting to commission visual effects from you?
It kind of goes to the getting in early. So I think the old attitude towards visual effects was picture post, which is you shoot a bunch of stuff and then some people do some stuff afterwards. And if you do that, the guarantee is you don't get the best use of the visual effects on the screen and you don't get the most of your money. You end up spending more and getting less. If you want to get the visual effects right, don't set the budget for visual effects before you've sat with the visual effects team and before you've got a script, which, you know, alarmingly has happened historically for years. sit down, talk about the appetite for visual effects in the show, work out how it can help, look at the creative vision, and then discuss how you can get as much of it on screen for the money as possible. But if you don't have those conversations early on, and you have them later, the later you have them, the more money you're throwing away, and the lesser your result potentially is. So it's about interaction and planning again.
Okay, so let's see what we get for our money. We've got an hour, got a whole series of clips, which Russell is going to talk us through, which is going to show us how we do it. I mean, a lot of them are centered around a bear fight. So Russell, over to you.
Yeah, so before we play the first one, I think what I wanted to do is I wanted to say it's kind of interesting what that last question, which is a great question. I think, you know, like I said, producers are so important to us because if we don't work with them, nothing really works. So in the case of His Dark Materials, what we did is we have to represent to the actors, to the directors, the demons and the creatures. And if you don't get a good performance from the people, you don't get a good result in visual effects. Even if our bear looks amazing, if the person doesn't look like they're interacting with it, it's dead in the water, you know? So we use puppeteering a lot, which is a traditional technique, to both give the actors something to act to, as well as giving the camera crew and the director an idea of the blocking and where we could put and where the framing would need to be. So what we had is we have two things. We have a scene in the show where a bear attacks a person, and then later we have a scene where two bears fight. And we approach them both extremely differently. The first one, we did in a very analog way, in that we did pre-visit and we did work out the rough blocking of it when we had the set, but we did everything with puppets, stunts, even down to, instead of having a complicated rig pulling the person around, we just had a stuntman in a grey suit pulling him around. And what that allowed us to do is be nimble, fast, not too expensive, but get, in my opinion, a really great result. So if we watch it, it's actually a breakdown of how it was done. So if you want to play the clip.
So over to you, Russell.
Yeah, so I think the main takeaway from that is that you would think that making a bear attack a person is an incredibly complicated and technical feat to film. Obviously, the post-production of that is really, really hard. And the intricacy and the detail that the team put into it is exceptional. But you'd think that the shooting would be prohibitively slow. But because of the approach that we took, it meant that we could get as many takes and as many shots as we could and as many goes at it rather than being bogged down by technology. So hence, you know, I mean, when we worked that out, first of all, I dragged around a stuntman. I actually dragged around Harry Melling, the actor, as well. And then the stuntman then looked at what I was doing, and then he did it and took it over and said, okay, fine, and did a better job. That's actually the next one. That's coming up, yeah. We did it on both. But what you do is you work this out quite physically, and then you try and make it as simple, like, you know, a bear's foot on a guy's head is a cricket glove that's white, so that as the hand touches the guy's face, you've got the reflected light coming off of the white glove that feels like a white paw approaching someone, but it actually still is quite lo-fi in the approach. And then what that allows us to do is it also allows us to focus on what matters. And I think a really good example of animation in that scene is the very last shot where we're looking up at the bear. And I remember reviewing that shot, and I review a lot of our animation with no sound, because I think that if you can understand the body language and the body language tells you what someone is doing, then the dialogue is a bonus. And I remember watching that clip and being able to see a thought process in the bear's mind and realizing that shot was working. So that's just a slight aside. But I think that that's a really good example of using very practical techniques to achieve a goal, which then brings us on to our next clip. So let's watch the next one, which is the next example of doing bears. Can we play that?
My bears! Yorick Bernison has come back! At my invitation, I drew him back, and I will destroy him. I've come here to give you a real fight. You fool. You are no king, and I will show you that. Obliterated. Why are you helping him? Liar!
So, a very different type of thing, because it is two CG creatures fighting, so we don't have to work out how to interact with a human. Now, we spent a lot of time in that set in our show. So we actually built the entire bear palace as a real set, with the exception of the roof, because we knew that it would be a VFX burn money-wise to just keep shooting it over and over again for no real reason, to keep doing visual effects shots of the backgrounds. So Joel Collins designed and built that amazing bear palace. We did the roof. And then what we had to do was put the bears into it, and we had to work out the fight. Now, we did this in a more virtual production, technologically sort of savvy way, I guess, 2.5 years ago, whatever it is now. But it again starts very practically and quite embarrassingly for me, with me wrestling a stuntman. So should we play that clip, and I'm going to talk over it. So nothing gets you somewhere quicker than people doing it. So what we did is, you know, I come from a bit of a martial artsy wrestling background, and I watched a lot of clips of bears moving around and you know, we looked at a lot of MMA reference, you know, in a very simple way, just for how people can collide and move around and shift each other's weight. And what we did is we blocked this sequence out with me, the directors there filming, producers, there's a virtual production designer there filming. And what we're doing is we're fleshing out the beats of the fight in a very simple way. And all of these beats, oddly, end up in the fight in the end. You know, it's all there. Only, you know, it's a bit depressing me seeing myself with a bit of shoot weight on there, but never mind. But yeah, so that's us working it out. And that allows the director to very quickly move us around, say, go over there, go over here, try this. What if you're further apart and then you collide? So you can stop playing this now, mostly for my moral or my emotional strength. So anyway, so what we do is you block it out as humans, and then we send that on to our animators. So if we play the next clip, this is that same performance that you've just seen of me and a guy wrestling, transposed onto our 6-foot-high, went on all fours bears. And it's us, and our animators just very crudely create the shape of the fight, but at true scale. And this set that you're seeing here, this CG set, is to scale to the real one that we built. So this now gets us the chance to look at the fight and say, okay, right, this is working. We've got our beats of action. We know we've got something that we want, but we don't yet know how we want to cover it with a camera. We can stop playing this one now. So what we've done is we've worked it out physically, very quickly, very reactively and responsively. We've then done our block animation using that as a reference. So then we then give our director his next round of input. So if we go to the virtual cam clip, what we did is we created, and this was done by the painting practice, they created the bear's palace as a game engine asset. And we took our animation of our bears from Framestore and placed them into that asset. And it could then run as a sequence. The director, Jamie Childs, could then take an iPad at Framestore and stand inside a virtual volume, and that iPad is being spatially tracked. And he can look at the iPad and film this sequence handheld as if he was there. And we always knew at the beginning we wanted a very kind of visceral sort of a very visceral fight where it felt like you were in the action. And what this did is this not only gave us an idea of how we might cover it, but it also confirmed an idea would work. So from there, the next thing is we don't want to build our set in CG. So if we go to if we stop this clip now, what we have is we have cameras that we like, that we sort of worked out. We have our virtual set made in Unreal, and we have our bears. So then what we can use is we use augmented reality. So if we go to the next clip, so the top right image is the bear live tracked through the viewfinder of the Arri Alexa and to the monitors into the space. And what this allows us to do is this allows us to film clean plates that work for the shots. So the DP, and in this case it was a second unit, a lot of this with me directing it, we can actually shoot the clean plates with the bears loosely tracked in here, and that is being driven through an augmented reality sensor on the camera that is a depth camera that is live tracking the environment. That is being sent back to the Unreal game engine, which is then sending the feed of the bears with about a 4-frame delay back to the camera. So then we can acquire all of our plates, but we know that they're going to work for the bears. So you can stop that now. So that gives you an idea of a more technological approach to a similar problem.
So Russell, you're working with very high-end DOPs and drama directors. And a drama director might come to a production like this having dealt with talent, actors, amazing sets, lighting and all the rest of it, but not VFX. How do you work with that director?
You have to first gain trust. That's a thing. And that's the soft skills of the job, which are really important. The supervision thing is a very soft skills exercise as much as it is as a knowledge about visual effects exercise. And then what you have to do is you have to walk them through the process and understand resistance, because often you get people who are kind of, you get some directors who are resistant to storyboarding because they don't want to make those decisions until they've worked with their actors to define the blocking of a scene. But sometimes something is so complex that you just need a plan, even if you're going to change it. You know, a plan is the thing you throw away, right? But at least you had the plan, so you've got a fallback. So what you do is you encourage them to use storyboards or previs or whatever it is that helps them get to the point where they think that they've got an understanding of what they want to do and you are confident that you can execute it for them so that they don't get disappointed at the end. And then on the day when you're filming, you offer up as many tools to them to help them visualize what they're looking at, whether it's a puppet, a ball with a stick with a ball on the end, or an LED wall with a bunch of Unreal Engine live inverse tracked backgrounds. It really doesn't matter. It's just about offering what suits their temperament and their personality and the rhythm at which they shoot. And fundamentally, it's about not making it a technical exercise when you film. It's about making it technical before and then an organic experience when you shoot. Because directors are instinctive, actors are instinctive, and if you can't respond to that, you lose the magic of what you're filming.
So we've got a question coming in from somebody who wants your advice, and this is from Tom, who says he's been teaching himself editing an animation from YouTube during COVID lockdown. He's interested in trying to get into the industry. Are there apprenticeships, traineeships? What should he be thinking about?
Yeah, there are. I think, there are courses you can do for a start. There's things like Escape Studios and places like that, which are not the same as doing a full university massive degree. But they're a good jump through the door. And there's also online courses like FX PhD and other online sort of resources, which although paid, what they give you is they give you footage to work on and targeted work to do. Because then it allows you to get together a showreel, and that showreel is really what gets you through the door. And my advice with showreels is, there is an understanding from visual effects supervisors and visual effects producers that if you're doing a showreel yourself, you don't have a Hollywood budget. So you shouldn't try and do some crazy elaborate scene that you can't pull off. The trick is to learn the tasks that you want to do well and demonstrate them clearly. So if you want to get into doing 2D, learn roto and comping and do simple tasks really, really well. I would also say now is a good time to learn the Unreal Game Engine if you like the 3D side, not only because the game engine world is very up and coming in the film and TV industry, but also it's one of the few things that is completely free and has amazing educational resources that are also completely free.
So I have another question coming in, which I think is one for the techie amongst our audience, which is from Shane, and it says, how do you feel about VFX being redone, such as Sonic and Justice League, and does this set a new standard in the industry?
I don't know. I think here's what I think. I think that people make mistakes. Okay, like when you're undergoing any kind of artistic endeavor, you have to do what you think is right in the moment, and you offer it up to the world, and they either like it or they don't. That's why when people ask me about the pressure of doing like a beloved property like His Dark Materials, and if that stresses me out, the answer is no, because I love the source material and I'm doing it all with love and with care and with attention. And then, like I said, you offer it to the world and they think what they think. And then if they don't like it, they should do it themselves, you know? So I think redoing visual effects is a strange thing. I think because it's basically like releasing a song and then people not liking it. So you just release it again with different notes. But I can understand it because the amount of money and investment and time that goes into it is you want it to land and do well. And if you're a visual effects artist and you're working on Sonic, you probably already know the things that are wrong. It's just you're being asked to do them that way. And all you really want is your work to be good. So if your job is to redo it, but it yields a good result, it's okay. You know, there's nothing worse than that feeling of releasing work and it being bad or not loved. It doesn't feel nice, you know? I mean, I'm comfortable with what I do and people having their own opinions. But I think when you pour over a shot for ages and people don't like it, it can hurt your feelings. So it's the same with cats. You know, you offer it up, people don't like it, you redo it. You know, I don't know. It's hard to know. I mean, people have been doing test screenings of TV shows forever. You know, they test, you know, commercials get made, test screened, and then thrown in the bin every week. You know, I mean, it's just a test screening, a trailer. So
In the closing minutes, you're just delivering His Dark Materials Series 2. It starts on Sunday. What next for you, Russell? What's your next big production?
Most likely, if all goes well, Season 3, which is great because all I've ever wanted to do really is finish the three books, you know. If not... I mean, my day job when I'm not supervising this show, which has been going on now for 3 years, so I don't know what my day job is anymore, is the creative director of TV at Framestore, which means just to help win work, be over the top of it, look at multiple shows at once, make sure that our output is really, really good and that we're hitting the mark. So, you know, maybe it's back to that and then another big show if season three doesn't happen, which it better do.
Yes, and for us as well as an audience. So can I say a huge thank you to Russell for sharing his considerable expertise with us this afternoon, and thank you to the audience for sending in such amazing questions. So awesome. Thank you and bye-bye.
Thank you very much.